It's an encouraging song to really recognize how dependent we are upon God, that we need to hold to His unchanging hand all the time. This morning, I want to talk about how our families can hold to His unchanging hand and how we need to be holding to His unchanging hand. I was afraid when Steve was starting through the slides up here that he was going to give away all the secrets before I even got up here. And he has revealed one of the questions that I really want us to ask. And really, I want us to be able to answer this question, because one of the secrets for a strong family is focus. Listen to what the Hebrew writer has to say. After Hebrews chapter 11, and describing all of these people who lived by faith and whose faith was marked by their actions, their faith was marked by their obedience and their response to God's word, he says, "Therefore, since we have this great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles, and let us run with endurance the race that is marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of the faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." And so we've looked at, well, the writer of Hebrews has looked at all of those people who've lived by faith, and I'd encourage you to examine their lives and notice that their faith was not idle. Their faith was not demonstrated by sitting around just having some kind of abstract belief. Their faith was demonstrated in the way they lived their lives. And in many of these cases, you'll see that their faith was an integral part of their family. Because they kept their families focused on Christ. Listen to what it says about Abraham, who took his son Isaac up to the altar to offer his son Isaac on the altar. Do you see the family involvement in that? I often wonder, what was Sarah thinking back home when they go up to make an offering and they have no animal? I mean, Isaac asks the question, where's the sacrifice? And Abraham has a profound opportunity to teach Isaac about the need to hold on to God's unchanging hand. And he says, the Lord will provide. And you see how their family was centered on God and centered on Christ, even though he was a couple thousand years from appearing. So the question is Christ the center of your home? I think probably all of us would answer with a resounding yes. We'd all respond in the affirmative, wouldn't we? This was a question that was posed to me by a couple of young men who came to my neighborhood. They were walking down the street. I was over getting our mail, and I was walking back to our house, and these two young men in nice bright white shirts with dark slacks and ties approached me, and they asked me this question: is Christ the center of your home? And I said, absolutely, without a doubt. And they pressed me a little bit and asked if they could come in and study the Bible with me. If we could sit down and study the Bible and to see how Jesus needs to be the center of your home. And I was a little bit puzzled by their approach, because I had already answered in the affirmative, but it was obvious that they did not accept my answer. Maybe it wasn't the center of the home the way they thought he should be. And maybe they were unsure of my idea of what it means for Jesus to be at the center of our home. In fact, what does it mean for Christ to be at the center of your home? How would you explain that? you've got to understand that we must be able to answer this question, especially to our children. We've got to be able to provide an answer, a meaningful answer that describes what it means to have a Christ-centered home. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 gives us a little bit of insight, especially into the home as we fix our eyes on Jesus. We have the examples of all of these people who give us a great witness of what it means to live by faith and have a God-centered, a Christ-centered family. Their eyes must be fixed on Jesus. And listen, to them, the people in Hebrews chapter 11, the cross and Christ was thousands of years away. He hasn't come yet. He was still just in a promise. And you see twice in Hebrews chapter 11 that it is explained that they all had faith, yet they had not received what was promised because they were looking forward to the Christ. The same way you and I look backward to the Christ. Their eyes were focused on Christ. It's like a camera lens. And you know when you take cameras, you know, we've got our resident paparazzi here, Brother Joe and Brother Charles. And you always see them walking around the building. They're always prepared. They must have been Boy Scouts or something. Be prepared. And they've always got their camera. And you can see when they're trying to get a picture, they walk up to you, they tell you to take a certain pose, and then they sit there and they're turning this little dial on the front of their camera. That's their lens. And what they're trying to do is get the clearest picture possible. They're trying to remove all of the blurriness from the image because they want to see very clearly in the picture that they're taking the object of their interest. And that's what it's like to fix our eyes on Jesus and to focus in. It's taking the lens of our camera. And the lens of our camera is through our eyes, but it goes much deeper than that, way back here into our heart. Now, I know I've got some young kids that are going to come up to me afterwards and challenge my anatomy, all right? But the Bible refers to the organ that lies between your ears as the heart. It's interesting because we want to see our image. If we're going to focus in our homes, if that's going to be a secret to a strong home, then we've got to be able to focus. And when our lives get blurry, when our families get a little fuzzy, then you're out of focus. Amen. And your eyes are not fixed on Jesus. And so one of the things that we must do is focus on His person. Who is Jesus? I mean, when you're asking if He's the center of your home, you know, one of the other questions that might follow that is why? You know, it's the perennial question of a 2-year-old, 3-year-old, 4-year-old, 5, you know, and that's their biggest question. Every answer you give them is followed by another why. So why would He be the center of our home? Well, you've got to recognize His person. And first of all, we recognize that He is the Son and the Lamb of God. Our kids need to know that. We as parents need to know that. And how will our kids know that if we parents don't know that? If we're not focused on that. In John chapter 1 and verse 29, as Jesus is introduced to the masses by John the Baptizer, He looks at this man who's walking down the hill toward the river, and He says, "Behold." That word "behold" is much deeper than the word "look." Behold conveys the idea of comprehension, and that there's something that you must understand when you see that man. Don't just see him, but behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We need to behold Him. We need to focus in on Him as the Son of God and as the Lamb of God. But we also need to recognize Him as the friend and the brother of man. In John chapter 15, verses 13 through 15, He's having this discussion with the disciples, with the 12, whom He is preparing for their ministry. He's about ready to leave. Jesus is about ready to die, be buried, rise again, and then ascend to the Father. He's leaving earth. He's been here for about 3 years. And he's getting ready to leave, and he's preparing his disciples. And he tells them, I call you friends. What a friend we have in Jesus. He's not ashamed to call us brothers, for such we are. The Bible describes Christians, you and me, as fellow heirs with Christ. We share one Father. Jesus' Father is our Father, and vice versa. And He is our brother. But also, He's the author and perfecter of faith, of the faith. Not just of your faith and my faith, of general faith, but of the faith, the one faith that Paul speaks of in Ephesians chapter 4. In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, he says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of the faith. In fact, in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17, it tells us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That Word that He has given, in fact, the Word that He is what gives us that faith, because He's the author of that faith. He's the perfecter, the completer of that faith. And so when we're focused on His person, there are tremendous blessings. Because when we focus on His person, then it motivates authentic worship. Why else would He be at the center of our home? We can bow down before Him in our homes. It deepens our devotion to Him, our allegiance, our affection to Him, and consequently our obedience to Him. And so when we focus on His person, then we're motivated to that authentic worship and a deepened devotion. But we also must focus on His presence. We focus on His person, who He is, but then we must focus on His presence, the fact that He is with us. In fact, in Matthew chapter 28, in verse 19 and 20, Jesus issues this great commission to the 12, well, to the 11. And He says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And then in the last verse, the last encouraging words that He gives, He says, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. He is with us. He's promised to be with us. And so when we look at His presence, we recognize His presence in the Word. In John chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. When you read that passage and you hear that personal pronoun, He, you understand that the Word is a person. And in verse 14, it says, that Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld. We didn't just see it, we beheld His glory. Glory as of the only begotten Son of God. And so we understand His presence because He's the Word. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 16 tells us to let the Word of Christ dwell within us richly. Listen, the more of this that we have inside of us, the greater His presence is. Does that make sense? I mean, Colossians 3:16, let the Word of Christ dwell within you. And you think about Romans chapter 10 and verse 17, that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of Christ, or the Word of God in your translation. And we understand that when it dwells within us, we experience the presence of Christ. But He also dwells within us in His Spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16, He tells us that our bodies are a temple of the Holy Spirit. He says we need to be careful with the way we treat our bodies. Amen. We need to recognize that this is a temple. Now, I know as you're looking up here at me, you're thinking, well, that's hardly a temple. Well, listen, that's what the Israelites thought when Ezra went back and rebuilt the temple. They said that's hardly a temple, but nonetheless, it's a temple. And it represents the presence of Christ in His Spirit. But then His presence is recognized in prayer. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6 says to be anxious for nothing. I just want to let that sink in for a moment. Be anxious for nothing. Everybody okay with that? Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, make your request known to God. Because in prayer, we connect with God through Jesus. His body is the veil, the Hebrew writer tells us. And when His body was crucified on the cross, He opened up the way for everyone to approach God, to draw near with confidence, to be bold in coming into the throne room of God. In fact, in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7, he says that we should cast our cares upon Him because He cares for us. And so we cast our cares on Him because He's with us in His Spirit, in the Word, and in prayer. We recognize His presence. And there's tremendous blessing when we recognize and when we focus on His presence. It's helpful when we focus on His presence in our homes. Amen. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Do your kids know that?
Yes.
Kids, do your parents know that? Because the blessings that are provided when we focus on His presence is that we can be calm under pressure. We can be patient under pressure. Why? Well, because we're anxious for nothing. Listen, when you start getting anxious and nervous and all kinds of frenzies in your home, then you're being too anxious. And Paul said, be anxious for... I heard echoes. Be anxious for nothing, but through prayer and supplication, make your request known to Him. And that generates a great dependence upon Him. There's patience under pressure when we commit things to prayer and recognize that we're not going through this alone. You think about the apostles, those men who would deliver the gospel to the world. As Brother Cobb shared with us, Paul, in taking that gospel boldly to a Gentile world who didn't even believe in God. I mean, the Jews believed in God. The Gentiles believed in everything else. And I mean everything else. And we need to recognize that the boldness comes from recognizing His presence. Lo, I am with you always, to the very end of the age. But it brings purpose to our parenting. We're going to talk about parenting maybe next week or so. But this purpose in our parenting, because then children, our kids, see our own awareness of the Lord's presence within the family. And it brings meaning to marriage. The great writer of wisdom of the Old Testament tells us that a cord of three strands is not easily broken. And listen, when you have a husband, a wife, and the Lord Jesus intertwined together in marriage, oh, there's great meaning.
Amen.
Oh, there's great purpose. Oh, there's great strength. And there is indeed great focus that helps us through even the most difficult times. So we focus on His person, we focus on His presence, but we also must focus on His promise. And He's promised to save us. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 25 tells us that He is able to save to the uttermost. Why? Because He lives. He lives to make intercession for us. And that's why He is able to save to the uttermost. Luke chapter 19 and verse 10 gives us one of those purposes for which He came. I came to seek and to save the lost. How many of you have ever been lost? Okay, that includes all of you. If you didn't raise your hand, you should. Because all of us have been lost. The Bible says that everybody has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. When you're given to a life of sin, you're lost. When you're not forgiven of those sins, you're lost. And you're not saved until there's forgiveness. And He's promised to do that. It speaks volumes of His ability. Last Wednesday night, in our class on the Gospel of Mark, we looked at a man who was lowered down through the roof, a paralytic who couldn't walk. He's on his pallet, and these four men couldn't get him to Jesus because of the crowd, and so they dug a hole in the roof, and they lowered him down right in front of Jesus, right through the roof. And Jesus does not immediately heal the man's condition. That's why they came. Was that so that he would be healed of his paralysis. But no, the first thing Jesus says, your sins are forgiven you. Well, you got to know that created a huge controversy within that little group that was meeting in the house. The controversy was that Jesus did not have the authority to forgive sin. Because only God can do that, you see? And so in Jesus forgiving the man's sin claims that he is God. And it speaks volumes of his ability. And to demonstrate his ability to forgive sin and his authority to forgive sin, he looks at the man and he says, get up, take your pallet and go home. And the man gets up immediately, begins walking and heads home. I mean, everybody's amazed by that. But you see Jesus' ability, you see His authority to forgive sin and to save us from sin, death, and hell. And in fact, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 39, we all know Acts 2 and verse 38, don't we? Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You got to understand verse 39. Don't leave 39 off of that. Amen. How many of you know verse 39? For this promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. You see, this is a promise, and it's not just to the parents, but it's for the children. And those children who are yet to come, it's for those who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. It's a promise. Amen. Forgiveness and the Holy Spirit. Promise upon which we must be focused. But He also promised to lead us. I like Isaiah 49 and verse 10 that talks about the leadership of Christ. He would lead people to streams of living water.
Amen.
And I love John chapter 4 because Jesus is doing exactly what Isaiah said. He has this conversation in John chapter 4 with this woman at the well, and he asks for a cup of water. The woman challenges him and says, well, you're a Jew, I'm a Samaritan, you're a man, I'm a woman, what are you doing talking to me? And Jesus says, if you knew who was asking you for the water, you would have asked Him and He would have given you streams of living water that would well up within you. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. But that's what Isaiah said. That's how Isaiah said He would lead. That's where Isaiah said He would lead. And in John chapter 4, Jesus is saying, this is where I'm leading, to those streams of living water. In John chapter 10, verses 11 through 18, he talks about being the good shepherd. And one of the great attributes of a good shepherd is the way they lead their flock.
Amen.
Sheep, which, by the way, that's us.
That's right.
You understand that? And sheep are not the brightest animals. Okay? I know that's demoralizing, humiliating. But you need to understand, sheep are not the brightest of animals. You can't drive them the way you drive cattle.
Absolutely.
You must be out in front of them, and you must be leading them to green pastures. I think I read that somewhere in the Psalms. He leadeth me beside still waters. You see this idea of a shepherd, the good shepherd. Now, this is a claim to be God when he says, I am the good shepherd. Go back to Ezekiel chapter 34 and you'll understand the background of that, that he's claiming here to be God, but he's claiming to be the shepherd who will lead the people.
Amen.
And he leads us into paths. He leads us beside still waters. He leads us into these lush, green, fertile fields, and he leads us to the streams of everlasting life. But he's also promised to come back for us.
Amen.
He has not left us here to our own devices. In John chapter 14 and verse 3, he says, I'm going to prepare a place for you, that where I am you may be also. And he says, I will come back for you. We're still waiting on that, aren't we?
Amen.
We're anxiously looking forward to that, aren't we?
Amen.
Some of us will die before he returns. But that's okay. Because 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 tells us that those who have died in Christ are going to be raised first. That's the first thing that happens when he returns. You're going to hear the trumpet sound. Listen, Nostradamus had no idea what he was talking about. Because you're going to hear the trumpet sound. And everybody asks you, well, what will it sound like? You'll know. Because you'll also hear the voice of the archangel. And the dead, the first thing that happens is the dead in Christ are raised. And then we who are alive and together will be caught up with them in the air. And we meet the Lord. It doesn't matter if you're on this side of death or the other side of death. He's coming for us. And that brings us great hope. That brings us great confidence. These are the blessings. I mean, when we're focused on his promise, we have a clean conscience. We can know that we stand before God as he has declared us righteous. We're not righteous in and of ourselves, but he has declared us to be righteous. And we can approach his throne of grace with boldness and with confidence. And we'll find grace to help in time of need. We'll find mercy when we come to him. Because that conscience is clean. There's a more determined discipleship. We're more intent on following him. We're going to follow closer. We're going to be more intentional about our discipleship. Because that's what we are as disciples. I mean, the Great Commission says, go and make disciples. And then you baptize those disciples. But a disciple is a learner. Because then Jesus says, teach them to observe all that I've commanded you. And that's what I'm trying to learn in this life. How about you? I'm trying to be taught all that he has taught. And I want that to be an engaging discipleship with a confident expectation of heaven. You see, we're not a people that has to say, you know, when this life is over, I hope that I have done enough to make it to heaven. Well, the fact is, you haven't and you never will. You can't. There's not a thing you can do to earn heaven. There's nothing that you can do to make it of your own accord, of your own effort. You've got to recognize on his promise. You've got to stand on the promises. There's a song or something like that, isn't there? Uh-huh. And so we stand on that promise of a clean conscience because sin has been forgiven. And there's a confident expectation that says, I know whom I have believed. In the song we sing, I know whom I have believed. I always liked that line. It was quirky to me. Believed. But we know there's a confidence. And we know that when life is over, we know where we're going. It's not a wishful thinking kind of thing. But there's a certain, a confident expectation of heaven. I know when this life is over, I'm going home. Why? How do I know that? Because He promised me. He promised me. And I'm living by those promises. Listen, when our eyes are fixed on Jesus, then He's the center of our home. Amen. When our eyes are fixed and focused on His person, on His presence, and on His promise, when we're focused, that's when He's the center of our home. So is Jesus the center of your home? Do the activities of your home reflect how centered you are on Jesus? Because when we're centered on Him, that makes our home life more about Him and less about ourselves. We're more concerned with Him being pleased in our home than me being pleased in my home. You see, that makes a big difference. Because the things that would please me might not be things that concern Him all that much. And it helps us to see the bigger picture, but it takes our focus off of ourselves and puts it where it needs to be, on the person, the presence, and the promise of Christ. Amen. But let me tell you something. He's only at the center of our homes. He will only be at the center of your home if He's at the center of your life. And if He is not the center of your home, you need to check and see whether He's the center of your life. Because just like Joe and Charles walking around here with their cameras trying to focus, if your home is marked by chaos, then you need to adjust the lens. Because I would suggest to you that you personally are not focused on Christ. And that's a secret to a strong home. Well, it's no secret anymore. And so if Christ is not in focus in your life, today's the day to adjust the lens of your camera. Today's the day to answer the question, is He at the center of my home? Is He at the center of my life? And you can answer that question right now while we stand and sing.